This picture here shows a group of fishermen in Sierra Leone, outside West Africa, pondering over the day's catch. As you can see in their nets, the fish there, or rather the sad remains of what could be fish, will not be enough to feed them or their families. This is a situation that is similar to coastal regions all over the world. So local fisheries simply cannot sustain their communities anymore due to overfishing. And overfishing is due to industrial reduction fisheries. The reason is this: large-scale trawl fishing. So this net contains 400 tons of jack mackerel, 400 tons in one single net. These nets can span entire square kilometers. There are super trawlers carrying nets which supposedly can fit up to 13 jumbo jets in one single net. 13 jumbo jets in one single net. Jack mackerel has decreased, the amount of jack mackerel in the ocean has decreased from 30 million tons to a little bit less than 3 million tons in just two decades. This is absolute insanity. And what is perhaps most insane of it all is that this fish is not even used for food, so you can go ahead and continue eating your Marine Stewardship Council certified fish. This is used for reduction fisheries going into mainly feed. Our oceans are actually on the verge of collapse. So 80% of the fish stocks are already fully exploited or overexploited. The World Wildlife Foundation came with a report last year that showed that over half of life in the ocean has disappeared within the last 30 years. Think of it, half, more than half of the life in the oceans just gone like that. There are scenarios by the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization that our fisheries might collapse in 2048. And that is what, not a little bit more than 30 years from now. Absolutely devastating. And as I said, this fish is not even used for food, it is used for feed. So if you think of the jack mackerel, it takes 5 kilograms of jack mackerel to produce 1 kilogram of salmon, farmed salmon. Insanity. So 80% of this fish goes into fish meal, which is used to make feed for animals and other fish. But 20% of it is going to fish oil. And fish oil is used in omega-3, in dietary supplements that are absolutely necessary. Omega-3s are fats that are absolutely necessary to our health, so it's a good thing that we make them. However, the way that we do them is not a good thing. And especially these 20% that go into fish oil and high-end products such as dietary supplements, they are really the driving forces of overfishing because they make it profitable. Now, of course, people are doing something about it. And this picture shows a Greenpeace activist just outside the coast of West Africa. And I love this picture because I love the image of the heroic spirit. It shows our courage, it shows our resistance as humans. But it also shows our helplessness against the huge powers that are in place here. And of course, the driving force for overfishing is business and profit. And the unfortunate and sad truth is that I do not believe that Greenpeace activists will be able ever to stop something so profitable as overfishing is. While, don't get me wrong here, I think activism is extremely important. I think it's extremely important that we call to action. I think it's extremely important that we have people and that we have organizations that call upon what's wrong in the world and that demand change. We need that. However, we cannot wait for regulations to come into place. And we cannot trust that just the simple awareness will bring about change. We need to empower change. And the most powerful game changer is actually using the same mechanism that drives overfishing in the first place, and that is business and profit. And one way to do it is to go back and look at nature and see what solutions she has in her back pocket. Because the irony of omega-3s is that it's actually not produced by fish, so we wouldn't need to use fish oil in the first place. One of the wonders of nature, I feel, is photosynthesis, and that is the capability of plants to take sunlight and carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and produce oxygen and all kinds of, you know, nutritional substances, materials, energy, and so on, the things we need and use today. And then a special interesting kind of plants that does this are the microalgae. Now, microalgae are unicellular little tiny plants, you can say, that live in all aquatic environments in the Earth. And they still produce 70% of all the oxygen that we breathe today. But they also produce a lot of essential nutrients, nutrients that are essential to life of animals and humans, because they are at the bottom of what we call the marine food chain. And one of the compounds that these microalgae produce are actually omega-3s, the same omega-3s that end up in the fish oil that is one of the drivers of overfishing. So this is one of these fantastic cases where you can just say that, okay, could we somehow do something about it? Could we industrialize growing algae? Could we commercialize omega-3 from algal oils instead of fish oil? And by that, we could simply wipe out the need for the middle fish. We could make overfishing less profitable by simply making algal oil so much superior to anything else that nobody would want to buy these fish oils anymore. And that is exactly what we set out to do. So the picture here shows what I would like to call a factory of the future. There will be many kinds of factories of the future that would look in different way, but I think that a lot of our future industry will be based on different kinds of plant-based photosynthetic processes. We often talk about the bio-based economy, and this is one example. And you have Fredrik here walking around in the greenhouses where we have those so-called photobioreactors where we grow our microalgae by photosynthesis to produce omega-3s. And he's not sitting there alone in this rubber boat in front of the large-scale trawler. He's going around there and he can just walk around and say, screw you, fish oil industry, we're doing this better. So this is what we do and this is how we simply get an omega-3 that is better for the planet, with the same health benefits and everything. So, you're laughing in front of me. The thing is here that this is just one example. If you look at the food industry, if you look at fisheries, if you look at agriculture, they pose some of the biggest challenges that we face in society. The way that we produce our food is simply not sustainable. The impact that fisheries and agriculture have on our environment are absolutely not sustainable. So we are in desperate need of disruption of the supply chain within this industry. We need new and better ways to produce things. Unfortunately, it's not enough to rely on consumer awareness and eco-certifications. It's not enough that some of us turn vegan so that we start eating crickets. It is not enough that we go out there in rubber boats and fight against the big trawlers. And it is also not enough to wait for regulations, because politics and political processes are very, very slow. So what we need is simply a new breed of capitalists, so to speak. People that start companies, that run companies, and are actually able, through innovation, to disrupt the existing food chain, okay, the existing supply chain of the food industry. This is a very, very important movement, and that is why I believe that the only way that we can bring about true change is actually by using the same system as we're operating in, which is business and profit and capitalism, because these are the strongest drivers that we have in the world today, as sad as it sounds. I do think that we need work together with activists. We do need to work together with all of the community as consumers that we are. But also, we must think of companies as part of society and as part of the community and use the positive forces that are in place here to bring about change. And that is, I think, that we can do by the means of business and profit. Thank you.